It's the book of Jonah, Jonah chapter 2, that's where we'll be. A lot of things to remember to pray for this week as you turn there. Just remember Wayne and his family, his mother, and all the things that are going on with that situation. And we also want to remember a family that are connected with the Weeks. You may have heard a prayer request for a little girl named Jordan. 8 years old, was in, hit by a car, and her funeral service will be sometime this week. And so be in prayer for that as we try to minister to the family as best we can as a church. We also want to continue to remember Brother Delmas Wilkins, and we want to also remember Judy Jackson. And Judy's on some blood thinners for a blood clot and that kind of thing, so we want to remember her and continue to lift those up in our church that are in need of a touch from the Lord, okay? As you've found yourself in Jonah 2, you're going to see that there are only 10 verses there, and that very simply, all this is a prayer to the Lord, and we have recorded in this prayer what Jonah was thinking when it ends in verse 17 of the previous chapter. Now the Lord had prepared a great fish to swallow Jonah. Jonah was in the belly of the fish for 3 days and three nights. And then after all of these things happened, remember, Jonah is looking back to this time in his life and he says, now let me tell you about the words that were on my heart and lips as I was inside the belly of this great fish and smelling very fishy and all the rest. He said, this is what I prayed to the Lord in those moments of desperation in my temporary residence here in this belly of the fish. Then Jonah prayed to the Lord his God from the fish's belly, and he said this, I cry out to the Lord because of my affliction, and he answered me. Out of the belly of Sheol I cried, and you heard my voice. For you cast me into the deep, into the heart of the seas, and the floods surrounded me. All your billows and your waves passed over me. Then I said, I have been cast out of your sight, yet I will look again toward your holy temple. The waters surrounded me, even to my soul. The deep closed around me. Weeds were wrapped around my head. I went down to the moorings of the mountains, the earth with its bars closed behind me forever. Yet you have brought me up, my life from the pit, O Lord my God. When my soul fainted within me, I remembered the Lord. And my prayer went up to you into your holy temple. Those who regard worthless idols forsake their own mercy. For I will sacrifice to you. With the voice of thanksgiving, I will pay what I have vowed. For salvation is of the Lord. So the Lord spoke to the fish, and it ralphed Jonah onto dry land. Or whatever you say in your household. Upchuck, maybe? We began last week by taking this little mini detour to Jonah after we were done with James and as we concluded our thoughts about Easter Sunday. And now we have discovered last week that God said to Jonah, go, and Jonah said to God, no, and now Jonah has been cast into this sea. And before he gets into the sea, Jonah came up with a great plan. He told God no, and he decided he was going to go his own way, and he gets onto this boat, and then God sends a tempest, a great wind and stormy seas. And this little boat is being tossed to and fro. And the sailors on the boat, they are trying to figure out what God is upset with them. They don't serve the one true God. And so they start going down their list. They're like, Frank, what did you do? You know, did you do something? No, I worship my God this morning. I'm good. What about you, Phil? Phil, what did you do? Nothing. I even called my mom yesterday. She's doing great. Okay, well, what's going on? And they go down depths of the boat, and they find that Jonah is asleep. And the captain wakes Jonah up, and he's like, Jonah, what's your occupation? Why are you on the boat? What's the name of your God? Tell us, because somebody has angered somebody, and we need to get it fixed. And in that interrogation, Jonah reveals that he knows why the tempest has come. He knows why the storm has come into their lives. And it's because he has been disobedient. And in his disobedience to the Almighty God, God is sending judgment. And he tells them that he believes if he is cast over the side of the boat, thrown into the water, he believes the tempest will stop. And so that's what they do. They throw him overboard, right? You see that in chapter 1. The crew picks Jonah up, casts him overboard. That's what the Bible says. And Jonah's now in the water, and now the big fish swallows Jonah up. And once he gets inside the belly of the fish, you notice in verse 1 of chapter 2, we are told immediately Jonah prays to the Lord his God. And as you read chapter 2 and as you heard it read to you, it will sound very poetic. This is very akin to the Psalms. The psalmists who talk about whether in the heights of this or in the depths of this, you are there, O Lord. And whether I hide from here or if I go there, you are there, O Lord. All of these things we read from the psalmist's heart, we read now from Jonah's heart. Why does Jonah speak these words in prayer? It's very simple, because Jonah was a man after God's heart. He was seeking God's truth. He was studying the Scripture. And when he prays the Scripture back to God, because that's his heart. And so what I want to do in just a few moments, and I'm not going to do it much justice, but before we jump into the details of his prayer, I just want to deal with prayer itself for just a second, okay? Because I think prayer is one of those things that in today's society, we've almost adopted it as a culture, just like we do Christmas or Easter or any other thing. Grandma's sick. If you could just send your prayers, that would be really good. You know, and not really meaning that prayer is going to work in grandma's life, but just send your thoughts and your good vibes and all the other things that people say today. And I was reading this article this past week, and it just kind of struck me as being so delusional about prayer. But let me just read a few sentences. This was called The Healing Power of Prayer Tested by Science. And in it, it was talking about how there is this a study that says that people who believe that they are being prayed for or are praying themselves to any kind of deity, that it has been scientifically proven to have some chemical benefit in their brain that helps them get some sort of peace in their disease, and that it helps them to overcome in their time of trial. But again, missing the point, let me read to you. Kate McPherson stands beside a table in Loveland, Colorado, praying for someone who is dying of AIDS, who has sent her a photograph. Now notice the word praying. She's praying for someone dying of AIDS. They've sent her a photograph. This is what it says. Dying of AIDS, and he is in San Francisco. This is someone that Kate McPherson has never met before. The photograph came to her by a response to an ad that she would pray for those who are sick, and that she knows that God will answer her prayers. With the photograph of the man in view, she moves her hands over the outline of his body, and with outstretched arms, Ms. McPherson says, "Now I can sense warmth, and I know I have this connection with God." And that warmth is speaking through the image and going to this man. Okay. I don't even know what that means, to be honest with you. But I do know that there are people who are searching for answers and believe that somehow prayer has some sort of mystical, magical ailment, that if they turn on the spigot of prayer, that something might happen. In the same article, it references somebody who's on the other side of the prayer debate. This guy's name is Richard Goss. He's the professor of biology at Brown University. And he says that if prayer and medicine go together, then it's completely wrong. He says this, If my doctor walked into my room after surgery and said, "Let me pray for you to have good recovery," I'd consider a malpractice lawsuit. I don't want a doctor who prays. I want a doctor who believes they did a good job and they knew what they were doing when they had the surgery on me. Okay. In the article, they also reference the best-selling book, Everything I Learned in Kindergarten, Robert Fulghum. I don't know if you've ever read the book, but let me just read to you what he says. I do not pray to any entity. My thoughts are of being at home in the universe. If you think of it, we are, in the ultimate meaning of things, not really separated from deity. There is nothing other to address because deity is all around us. It's like a fish trying to decide whether to relate to the ocean. The fish is in the ocean. There's no need to relate to it. No need to find it. It's already been found. You're in it. Do you think any of those answers are helpful about prayer? I don't. I don't find any of those to be helpful. I'm going to, like a fish in the ocean, I'm not sure whether to relate to it or not. I don't understand where they're coming from. And whether there are people in our culture today that think that prayer has some sort of psychological benefit to it that they're going to use for their benefit or for the benefit of others to overcome illness or disease, that is not what prayer is all about. And society has it wrong if that's their answer to what prayer is. Prayer can also, in the life of the church, not be existent either. And we too can get wrong views about what prayer is. And so I'm going to take the time this morning to talk about what prayer is just very briefly. And what I want to do is I want to give you some truth from a seasoned pastor. His name is William Still, and I recently found his writings. I thought they were really good. He pastored the same church for 52 years, which is a feat in and of itself. For them to put up with him and for him to put up with them, I mean, that's saying something, 52 years. I mean, he's, you know, baptizing great-great-great-grandchildren by that point or something like that. And so, you know, he's there, and he was well-known for his preaching, but he was better known for his prayer life. And it was not uncommon for him to stand before his church every Sunday and preach for about 20 minutes and pray for 25 minutes. And the little kids in his church used to take notes during his prayers because his prayers were so soaked with God's Word. But this is what he says about prayer, and I found it very helpful. He says this, "Prayer for the Christian is a matter of believing that God is, and that because God is, God answers those who believe in Him." I thought that was a good definition. Prayer for the Christian is a matter of believing that God is, and that that God responds to those who believe in Him. That's the start. That's our approach to prayer. God exists, and God cares. God answers. Let me briefly just give you a few thoughts from his book. The Christian is indwelt by the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is God and is naturally therefore in touch with the Father and the Son. On the basis that we know something about this God from the Holy Scriptures, we begin to speak to Him inside of our spirit and should do so as naturally, in a sense, as we speak to anyone else in our lives. Our better selves, born of God in Christ Jesus, that's prayer. We have to believe that God is there and God is listening. Not that by believing we might make Him there, but we have to remind ourselves that He's already there and that every time we call upon His name, He is there. We're not speaking out into the night. We're not simply getting things off our chest. We're not simply meditating or doing some sort of exercise and deep breathing with some words that go along with it. Our God is alive and well, and He hears us when we pray. Because my God doesn't sleep or slumber. And if you're real about this, he says, and you believe in what you're doing, prayer, instead of being a matter of times and seasons and special occasions, which of course are all important in the life of the church. And by the way, he says, for the last 52 years, from the hours of 7 to 9 every Saturday evening, we've had prayer at my church. But he says this, if we understand that prayer is not just about special places, prayer is not just about special seasons in our life, prayer is not just about the special occasions in our life, prayer is not just the meals of our life, but prayer is our life. It becomes such a vital part of life that it refocuses how we look at life. It becomes so positive and creative that it lifts our spirits far beyond any doubt or depression or attitude. And one of the things that such an attitude of prayer does is to free our minds from the narrowness of thinking that God is simply the supplier of our needs. Oh, that comes into it very much indeed, but there's far more to it than that. It's not just that He supplies our needs, He says. When we pray, we become interested in God. In the same way, we become interested in someone who we have deep, long, meaningful conversations with. We become interested in God. We become interested in His ways. We become interested in His doings. We become interested in His Word. And all the time this is going on, we are quite unconsciously building a new character. We're being affected because of our conversations with Him. We begin to see His point of view better than we ever have through prayer. And we start to get a sense. We start to agree with God in areas we never agreed with Him before. And in prayer, we find humility. Unselfconsciously, it comes to us as an attitude of sheer delight. This, I believe, is what Genesis speaks of when it says, Enoch walked with God, and he walked with God to such an extent that God said in the end, O man, come away up. You'd be better here than there because all of your interests are always already heavenward. It's hardly likely to go as far as that with you and me, but there were others who walked with God in this way, and their lives shone with a glow of living in such positive, world of grace, that despite of any trial or any trouble that might have come their way, their life was nothing but full of joy. I find those words to be liberating. That prayer is so important to us that it helps us not to see God as the benevolent Santa Claus that gives us what we need and want, but we see God in light of our relationship with Him. His truth we desire above all things. To walk in His ways greater than walking in our own ways. To have a new view of life that we would not otherwise have, but that we have entered into His presence in prayer. I found all of that to be important. It reminds me of, well, the old song, He walks with me, He talks with me, He tells me I'm His own. We only get that when we talk with Him in prayer. And there are times and seasons when there will be opportunities for you to pray to God and praise Him for things that you might not normally do. I was driving out near Catlett or something like that, and I had the windows rolled down. That was my first mistake. It's like going through Lancaster, Pennsylvania, with your windows down. Big mistake. But I've got all these cows moving on both sides of the, and the fertilizer is just filling in your vehicle, and you know, fresh air is overrated, you know. I'll take Woodbridge air any day. And but I remember in that moment, and I'm not trying to be super spiritual. Look to your pastor. He's not, you know, walking on the ground. But I remember in that moment, just it came to my mind, Lord, thank you for how you design the world. Yes, fertilizer doesn't smell so good, but you know what? It fertilizes. It creates growth. Thank you, Lord, for the things that we're able to grow and do, because this is how you've made cows and you've made things. This is a part of your design. And then I was thinking about vultures and all the birds of prey and things like that. Lord, you took care of so that death wasn't just around, but these animals that come and I don't know, my mind just started going, praising the Lord for all the things he gives to us that I normally would not consider, trust me. Normally things that do not cross my mind to praise God about. But in that moment, those things just kind of flooded into my mind. Just pray, thank you, Lord. You're good. You do great things. And I hope, and I pray that we are becoming the kind of Christians that want to have these conversations with God, and that when the unbelieving world is going through trials and trouble, they know that you're somebody that they can rely on. I was listening yesterday to this podcast, and the story just kind of stuck out to me because we were talking about prayer anyway this morning. But this is what she said. This woman, she lives in Atlanta, and she was going to a ladies' conference, a women's conference there in Atlanta, to this very famous speaker. There was probably like 10,000 people there. And she herself was getting ready to speak at her church the very next week about some women's ministry that they wanted to get started. And she said, you know, I'm just somebody who goes to a church of 100 people, you know. I'm nothing, you know, but this person, you know, she's able to preach to millions, you know, of women and really encourage them. And she said, you know, for whatever reason, I felt really nervous about approaching her, but the topic she was preaching or speaking on was prayer. And so because she was speaking about prayer, I wanted to go up to her and ask her to pray for me because I was going to have this speaking engagement. I was very, very nervous. And so she said, I waited until everybody in the line went through to greet the speaker. And it was just me, and it was her. And I said, I don't know why I'm so nervous, but she said this. She said, I took off my name tag, and I said, would you pray for me? This is my name. And the woman said, yes, I'll pray for you. And she took the sticker. And then as she's telling the story, she goes on to another story, and then another story, and then another story, and then she gets to this story. She says this. We wanted to add an addition to our home, and so we hired this old guy. We know he's old because he went by the name Old Man Brown, okay? And so she said, you know, he took forever, way over budget, but he became part of the family. You know, he'd come in, smell the dinner, and say, what's for dinner? And we'd say, ah, spaghetti. He'd sit down for an hour and eat with us and talk with us and then go do a little bit of work. Or get up and say, you know what, I've been here enough, I'll come back tomorrow, you know, that kind of thing. And she said, but over time, he just became a part of the family. And she said, one day, some months later, Old Man Brown said, how do you know so-and-so? And then she said, wait, hold on. How do you know that I know so-and-so, this famous speaker? And he said, oh, well, she hired me to do some work at her house, and I saw your sticker above her sink in her house. And I asked her how she knew you, and she said, I pray for her every time I wash the dishes. And she said, what an encouragement to know that someone who speaks to thousands and thousands took the time to say, I'm going to pray for this person whom just asked me one time. I know nothing about her details, but she said, will you pray for me? And she stuck that above her kitchen sink to pray for me every day. That's the kind of spirit that I hope one day I have, that somebody, when they say, will you pray for me, that is something that is habit, that is something that they know they can count on, that it's not just a one-time prayer, this person is continually bringing me before the Lord in prayer. When I was in Nashville, there was a little old lady at Trinity Free Will Baptist Church, and when she died, the preacher told a story. She used one of those big binder clips, and she had all of these note cards, and she had them in order, and she would pray for this person and flip it over, and every day she was praying for each card, and as the Lord answered the prayer, she would open the clip, take that card out, and she would put it in a tub in her house, and then she would keep adding and all the rest. And they brought that tub to the church, and they poured it out. There were thousands of cards of people and situations where she heard the prayer request, and she said, I'm not going to forget that. And she wrote it on a card to pray for that. And then they read each one of those prayer things that she was still praying for, and they prayed for that during the service one more time. Before they put that little old saint's body into the ground, you know, one more time to pray for each one of those names and situations. You know, it's a reminder to us that that's the kind of spirit of prayer we should have as Christians, that we go to the Lord and that's a habit of our life. And it's one that we very often don't think we do very well. I think if we polled one another, And one of the reasons why is because there's so many opinions about prayer. Let me tell you, you pray. You pray when you wake up, and you pray as you're going throughout the day, and you pray when you're lying down. And then when the next day the alarm rings, you pray again, and as you're going throughout your day, you pray, and as you go to bed, you pray. And that's the life that you live. That's the habit of your life. It doesn't require a special building. It doesn't require that you come down to the front to pray only here at the church. It doesn't have to be right here and right now that you pray. The Lord hears you wherever you are. The psalmist says He's but a whisper away, and we can hear the still small voice of God speak back to us. God's able. Over the years, I'll tell you this story really quickly and then move on. Over the years, people have tried to talk about how to pray to the Christian, and I thought this was just a funny little anecdote. It's a little poem. I'm going to give it to you. The proper way for men to pray, said Deacon Lemuel Keyes, the only proper way is to pray on your knees. No, I should say the way to pray, said Reverend Dr. Wise, is standing straight with outstretched arms, with rapt and upturned eyes. Oh, no, 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 said Elder Snow. Such posture is too proud before the Lord. A man should pray with eyes fast closed and head contritely bowed. Well, it seems to me his hands should be austerely clasped in front and with both his thumbs pointing to the ground, said Reverend Dr. Blunt. Well, last year I fell in Hodgkin's well head first, said Old Man Smith, with both my heels a-sticking up, my head a-pointing down. I done prayed right there and then, the best prayer I ever said. That was the prayingest prayer I ever prayed. That was standing on my head. Well, that was pretty good. So whether you're on your knees or you're standing up with outstretched arms, or whether it's fast-closed eyes, or whether your hands are clasped in front, or whether you're standing on your head, pray. Doesn't matter about your posture. Pray where you are, and the Lord hears you. Now, I spent more time on that than I wanted to, but maybe that was for all of our benefits. Let's take a look very briefly then at what Jonah's prayer has to say to us about Jonah, his relationship with the Lord, and how we can learn from it. What we learn about God is found in verse 9. Salvation comes from the Lord. And even in his distress, Jonah realized that. There is little doubt that Jonah had, in the immediate aftermath of the events on the sea, a realization that salvation comes from the Lord. Why? He's still alive. God's grace, he's not dead, he did not drown. God provided a great fish to swallow him up. In verse 2, he gives us a summary. He says, I cried out to the Lord because of my affliction, and he answered me. Out of the belly of Sheol I cried, and you heard my voice. He was in the water, he says. Half drowned, he says. He even says later that the seaweed was kind of all wrapped around his head. You see that in verse 5. He said, all these things were happening. He said, and then I cried out to God, the God who I ran away from, and I discovered what the psalmist said was true. O Lord, you search me. You know when I sit down, when I stand up. Where can I go from your presence? If I go to the heavens, you're there. If I make my bed in hell, you are there. And Jonah realized that to be true. In the stormy sea, there was God. He discovered that God answers the cry of those who call out upon him. And from the depths of the water, he cries for help. And God listened, and he heard his cry. And he provided a means of grace through the great belly of the beast. Why? Why was he there? Disobedience. He had run from God, and yet in his disobedience and in his lack of doing what God had called him to do, God still showed Jonah a measure of grace. And I would say to all of us today that in all of our lives, we have things that we can look back to in the past and say, I have failed and I've made mistakes. And perhaps you failed in ways that are larger than you think God's grace can cover. But I'm going to tell you that God's grace is boundless grace. We sang about it this morning. Amen. Our sin abounds, but sin can be measured. It's like a mountain. If you could pick the mountain up and put it on scales, you can measure it. You can see how tall it is. You can see it. You can test it. You can see sin. Sin abounds, yes. But the Bible says grace is greater than sin. Grace is boundless. Grace cannot be weighed or measured. Grace covers sin. There is no height to our sin or depth to our sin that grace cannot reach the height or depths of and free us from the consequences of that sin. Because God has determined to complete the work that He began in us. That's what Paul says. Whether it's the young prodigal son who finds himself in the pigsty, or whether it's the prophet Jonah who finds himself in the belly of a great fish, God seeks us out. And when we get our senses about us and we lift our eyes to Him, the Lord is there to dust us off, to vomit us out, to clean us up and put a robe and ring on our finger and say, welcome home. That's the God we serve. In our distress, we reach out to God and He answers us. Notice in verse 3, He says that He was cast into the deep. And notice who He says cast Him there. You cast me into the deep. Now, the average boy or girl who's in this room this morning and was here last week, you may immediately say, well, I don't know about that, Jonah. Jonah, didn't you tell us a whole story about how you were asleep and you told them and the people cast you over the boat? Weren't you the one who told us that story? And now in chapter 2 you said it was God who cast you over? Jonah's recognizing that the sailors were just the hands of God to do God's purpose. And that ultimately it was God who wanted them in the water that day. It's the same story we get with Joseph and his brothers who sold him into slavery. And after being sold into slavery, banished to Egypt, lied on, and all the rest. In Genesis 45, we have Joseph who says these words to his brothers who are in fear that now retribution is going to come. It wasn't you that sent me here. It was God. And at the same time, the sailors didn't really throw him over. It was God who used them for His purpose. Jonah, we got to talk. That's what God said that day. Wake him up. Get him over the boat. We've got to change Jonah's location because Jonah's not listening. I sent the storm. It didn't even wake them up. All the sailors are in distress. You know, if there had been cell phones, I love you, Julie. I'm not coming home, you know. And then there's Jonah. He can care less. Send the tempest, O Lord. I'm asleep in the boat. So God had to use the sailors to say, get him overboard. He hasn't got the message yet. And I think for all of us, if we've lived the Christian life any length of time, you can look back and you can say, I wasn't listening here, and I didn't listen there. And then God sent this person, I didn't listen to that. And then God took this away, but I didn't listen to that. I doubled down. And then I did this, and then I did the other thing. And then 7 years later, now I can look back and say, boy, I would have missed a lot of aggravation, a lot of hurt, and had a lot of money in my pocket if I would have just listened the first time God intervened in my life and said, we've got to talk. And it took me having to go all this time, all this money, all of this, these resources, to lose it all, for me to realize I should have been talking to God all along. That God was trying to wake me up the whole time, but I was asleep in the bottom of the boat. And it took God throwing me overboard for the only rescue to be Him, where I said, Lord, You are the God of my salvation. I can't do it anymore. I need You. And God saying, I've been trying to talk to You for a long time. But while I got You here, let's deal with some things. But probably greater than him believing and knowing that God had cast him into the sea. You see verse 4? Not only did You cast me into the deep, I have been cast out of Your sight. That there was a moment when Jonah didn't feel the presence of God. It doesn't mean that God wasn't there, but Jonah couldn't feel God anymore. We talked about that this morning in Sunday school in Romans chapter 1. That we know that judgment is coming, but yet we deceive ourselves. God gives us over to these things that we want to do, these sins that we want to commit, and we're calloused to the things of God. Jonah had grown callous to the things of God. He heard the voice of God say, go, and Jonah said, I know better than God. No. That's a calloused heart. And it took God sending judgment for that calloused heart to be ready and receptive to hear the truth of God. And some of you might be in that point of where God is dealing with you about some things and you don't know quite yet what God's plan and purpose is for the next step. Because I don't know how much time elapsed from the Lord spoke to the fish and it vomited Jonah onto dry land. And now you have Jonah trying everything. There's no bounty towels out there and there's no fragrance out there that's going to get that fish smell. You've been in the belly of a fish for 3 days. I'm sorry. A fisherman comes off the boat. They've had like 10 fish on there and they still smell like fish for weeks afterwards. And he lived there for 3 days. I don't know. Trying to clean up all the seaweed and all this other stuff. I don't know how much time elapsed from the time he was on dry land before the Lord spoke to him again. But I do know that perhaps what he's thinking is, okay, the Lord's heard my prayer. I'm on dry land now. But is God going to use me? Is God going to send me to do the work? Or am I unusable now? Maybe God called me to go. He said, arise and go. I went another direction. Have I lost my opportunity to be used by God? Have I lost my opportunity for God to do something great in my life? Has that call been removed from my life? And the glorious verse is in chapter 3, verse 1. And the word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time. Because God is a God of second chances, and third chances, and fourth chances, and fifth chances. And I've got some time before lunchtime, so six chances and seventh chances and eighth chances. And all the chances you think God is finally going to say, enough's enough, He's got one more, and then another, and then another. Because God is a God of grace. When we run, when we fail, when God even sends terrible things to wake us up and get us to rely on Him even more, God's mercy meets us. The devil comes, and the devil whispers, you're finished. You're all washed up, literally. He tells you that God can never use somebody who's done these things. And when the devil whispers in your ear, you speak boldly back, no, my God says, come. And when I come and I ask Him to be there, He'll be there. Because my God does not leave me nor forsake me. Because salvation comes from the Lord. Not myself, not in my doing, not in my keeping. Salvation comes from the Lord. Saving me from the penalty of sin, saving me from the power of sin each day, saving me from the devil's lies. And we cannot forget the truth. God is the God of salvation. Let's pray. Father, this morning You have spoken through Your Word and reminded us of the importance of prayer. Wherever we are, in whatever situation,